and sexual references.
Aboriginal and Torres Strait Islanders are advised that this program contains images and voices of people who have died.
It was the beginning of 1975 and a new era in public broadcasting was dawning.
When Double J burst onto the air, it changed everything.
Just off the main drag of Sydney's King's Cross, a group of young radicals launched a radio station that was to become a national icon.
There was no way you were going to hear on commercial radio what you were hearing on Double J.
The station, affectionately dubbed the J's, went on to break countless bands and change Australian music forever.
Give it up for Missy Higgins.
Triple J, they gave birth to me in a way, which is a really weird thing to say.
Hello world, pants off Australia.
Mining the fertile ground of Aussie larrikinism, the station spawned the radio comedy duo.
Well, the kiddies like adults being silly.
They do.
And we were very silly.
We never felt the burden that we were servants of history and that we had to represent everybody, because you can't do that.
That's right, Mikey. Yeah.
Most of the time we spent on air bickering about where we were going to go for lunch.
Mm. Yeah.
All right, thanks for the call there. Gary in Brisbane, what do you think?
Oh, I reckon the whole system needs a shake-up.
The J's is a talk to the heart of the youth. All across Australia, people love it.
Triple J.
Triple J are the furthest thing from Brave in terms of their playlist. They're extremely predictable.
I guess Triple J is in such a unique position. They'll probably cop a lot of criticism for things they actually probably lead the field in.
Now, as it contemplates middle age, its stars past and present reflect on 40 years of the Australian youth station.
Triple J is much like the 60s. If you can remember your time there, then you weren't actually there.
Bleep, 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 bleep. J, J, J.
Happy birthday!
Happy birthday to Triple J!
Happy birthday!
Happy birthday, Triple J. Like everyone else, you're getting older.
Happy birthday! Happy birthday to you!
I usually sit up as quickly as possible. I go downstairs, I have a glass of juice, and then I have about 7 minutes of me time on the couch. And then I message Alex and I say, leaving now.
That's every day.
Every day.
Every day, the same message.
Leaving now.
Sometimes I get out of the shower and get the leaving now text while I'm standing there naked. So I'm quickly scrambling to get downstairs.
Hey, oh, how's it going? Yeah,
good. Every single day I wonder, I don't know if I can keep doing this anymore.
Adelante.
This is Triple J Breakfast. Good morning!
Young people just want to hear that kind of up-tempo excitability in the morning to get them out of bed.
So what just happened there? Did she sleep with her boss?
You bet she did. And got a promotion.
And got a promotion?
Yeah.
A buzzword that I hear around the offices when I think about past Triple J Breakfast presenters is irreverence, and it's something Triple J is really good at. You can break a few rules and, yeah, it's sort of giving the middle finger to the system, or so to speak.
1-300-0555.
Triple J now would not exist if it wasn't for that pioneering group of people who had this crazy idea in 1975 to start a radio station for young people.
Demonstrators, both pro and anti, exempting him as a conscientious objector from union membership.
Australia in the early 70s was emerging from 23 years of conservative government. The new Whitlam era spelt revolution across society, paving the way for a groundbreaking youth station on AM radio.
It was Gough Whitlam who set up Double J as an experimental station. There was still a culture of opposition between the old guard of the RSL and the moral majority type of people, and young people, a lot of young people anyway, felt very alienated from that.
We'd come from a long history of incredibly boring radio.
So when Double J started, which was only in Sydney, by the way, it was an experiment in something quite radical.
Ready, set.
Everything came together at the right time in the right place, and it just went. It was like a dam busting when it all took off.
Right on the stroke of 11 o'clock on the 19th of January, we cut to the Skyhook song, You Only Like Me Because I'm Good in Bed. It was just a sensational moment of broadcasting as far as I'm concerned.
We chose to open the broadcast with a song that had been banned by commercial radio, in particular 2SM, who were kind of the bête noire of people who like good music, and 2SM was widely regarded at the time as rubbish. 15 times a week and
you still want more. Well, I was a big Skyhooks fan. It was like a gale of fresh air had suddenly blasted out of the radio speaker. Because everything up until that point in time had been so stultified and so regimented and so narrow. It was just almost unthinkable that suddenly we could hear a song like this broadcast. Just like me, 'cause I'm good in
bed. Oh, you just like me. We just like you anyway. On behalf of everybody at Double J, welcome. Guess who's nervous?
The adrenaline was pumping and, oh, I was going to say this and I was going to say that, and then when the red light went on, I couldn't remember any of it.
Let's go.
I chose the second song, which was the Rolling Stones' Sympathy for the Devil, and I didn't find out till later that it was also banned by the radio stations for a long time.
We've lost the news.
It didn't work. That's nice, that is.
A slight technical difficulty. Everyone's got white knuckles, people are ringing each other.
The first day was full of mishaps and excitements of one sort or another, but once we were rolling, it started to smooth out a bit and we got on with the job.
You're running 7 days a week, 24 hours a day. You got enough people and facilities to do that?
Is
that...
We're all working pretty hard.
It was quite anarchic. You know, it wasn't Johnny Rotten anarchic.
We were known as the semi-autonomous collective. The bosses were elected.
There were two so-called coordinators.
Someone in a newspaper article called us Radio Commune.
We're not really the power guys. It's everyone sort of pitches in.
The direction of the station was run by a series of meetings. Everybody sat around on cushions and couches and talked out what was going on.
The Wednesday meetings that were supposed to go for 2 hours and would literally go as many hours as the last person talking could last for. And if you were the last person talking, your point won. So there was a lot of long talking.
We have some wonderful arguments with everyone working on the station about what we should be doing, what we shouldn't be doing.
We had violent arguments about music, and that was the evidence of it, was that people disagreed strenuously about what we should be playing.
If you're into JJ Daddy, you're far out, right on. 2JJ, or 2JJ as they call it, is solid rock. And it's already captured 20% of the under 25 age group in Sydney.
I saw everything through the music. It was this alchemy of post-prog, jazz fusion, hippie 60s stuff, combining with dance music, big disco thing going down in 75, hence the Saturn flares and the chiffon top and the cork platforms. You try programming a 24-hour radio station with all those things going down. Not easy, you know. Because the landscape was so free and open that we were obliged. It was our duty to play as much from the broadest possible source in reggae. Because we had no boundaries, we were leading, the commercial radios were listening and picking out the creme de la creme which we found, and then they'd use it, right? So we were leading the way, we were making the rules. We're smashing the rules, we're making new ones.
Well, I've always been interested in traditional music from lots of different countries. I suppose the first area that I fell in love with was music from Ireland and from England and Scotland.
Because of the timbre of my voice, I was regarded as the nighttime guy. I had 3 hours, basically, to play anything I wanted to. Over a period of time, the station collected some 70,000 albums, so there was a lot of music on the premises, and 50 or 60,000 singles. An overseas band that we pushed were the B-52s, who commercial radio wouldn't touch. And we just thrashed Rock Lobster, which was their big hit at the time, to the extent where 2SM picked it up, which was very gratifying for us.
Commercial stations only ever played short songs so that they could get more commercials in. And Dire Straits comes out with a song called Sultans of Swing, but it's 7.5 minutes long. Just about every disc jockey on the station just goes, oh, God, I love this song. So Sultans of Swing goes on high rotation on Double J. You probably hear it 6 times a day. And this is an album that's come out in England, done nothing, come out in America, done nothing. Comes out in Sydney, starts selling like hotcakes, and then starts to rocket around the world. So, you know, it's quite influential.
At the same time, in Australia's pubs and clubs, Aussie punk was making noise. And Double J was listening.
By the late 70s, there were bands coming out of the woodwork. They were everywhere, fabulous, all over Sydney and from outside of Sydney.
It was seen that ABC should be doing more in supporting Australian contemporary music. Lots of people within the station had a view about sort of what we could do. The first one was sort of live concerts. We'd put on a concert and we'd record it. We'd put on 3, 4, 5 bands, which was pretty good.
Double J also recorded now classic Australian rock bands like Cold Chisel in its Sydney studios and played them on air, as well as broadcasting live new music uncovered in inner city and suburban pubs.
Sometime around about 78, I've received this phone call from a music publisher and she said, do you want to go and see this band? She said, they're a bit weird, but exciting. I saw this guy leaping up and down, running up and down the stage. I thought, there was just something about it, just something about the energy.
Midnighter was a very strong live band. We spent a lot of time in the pubs and on surf clubs. And of course, the music that we were writing and creating at the time wasn't the sort of music that was likely to find ourselves on commercial radio airplay. But there was this radio station that might give it a shot. Double J helped us become the band that we could be, and we were providing music along with our peers for them to play. So there was a kind of neat symbiosis happening then, and it went on from there.
Good morning, Alan McGurk.
I had come over from commercial land. I was hired to do the breakfast show. And I'd done breakfast for 5 years and nobody else wanted to get up early. I walked in the door, they said, what you lack in entertainment, you make up for in bad taste. It's just what we need. So I got the job.
In Sydney, it's one hell of a hot day coming up, believe it. Wear the flimsy blouses, girls. Hot today, tempered with...
Prime part of a radio day is breakfast in particular. And comedy was our brief.
I'm a mental detective and I always listen to Double J 1540 because they don't talk down to you.
Mari said, I'd love to get comedy onto J's and could we get the boys from the Artie Jack show to do it?
Arr, be the station, Jim Ladd.
Here be good ship, Double J.
Arr. Well, all the kiddies out there, why don't you scuttle your undies and be on Double J in the roar? Arr.
We turn up at Double J then, before they got the extra joint. J. And we'd turn up with Gary McDonald, always claimed that nude radio is responsible for his extra ulcers.
Ah! Ahoy there!
Hello.
We were, you know, television people, so we had to learn a few tricks of radio, but we had all the characters that we'd done on television.
And new ones, and we invented a whole bunch of new ones.
One character was a piano teacher called Miss McKinley. And she was the rudest piano teacher in the world, and everything she talked about always ended up being of some sort of pornographic nature. In the end, dear, but she came out of Auntie Jack.
So tonight it's hello to all the boys and girls in khaki.
I walk down memory lane.
I didn't do Auntie Jack, but we developed lots of characters, but Gary in particular got Gunston up and running.
I am Norman Gunston. The Premier of South Australia is Don Gunston.
Cue Norman. Tell Norman I'll cue him to lift the phone, okay, as per.
We'd be in the middle of a sketch and suddenly, you know, like a phone would ring. And you'd have to bounce off it. You'd have to go wherever that was heading. You'd have to follow it.
What be that? That be the phone.
But radio has that thing that television doesn't have. Theatre of the mind. It's just a great way of engaging the consciousness, isn't it? Radio is fabulous.
Thunder of the Space Patrol!
The transport ships come alongside, Chuck.
On the weekends, there was a lot of comedy.
Jim, will you get out of here?
Oh, okay.
Oh, Chuck, you only...
There was a program called Chuck Chunder of the Space Patrol, which was a takeoff of science fiction serials before Douglas Adams was even heard of, if you like.
Oh, hi. Wow. You're everything I've expected, Colonel Chunder. May I call you Chucky?
Oh, shucks. Of course you can, Toots.
I should have put on the blockout cream.
Captain, good vibes. Talk like this, mate. And he said, oh, I met this great Sheila on the weekend. Oh, great tits, all eight of them. He was a pig. Captain Good Vibes was a sexist character, which in itself was a satire of the sexism inherent in male surf culture at the time.
What a pity I'm feeling so full of aggro.
Feminism was very, very strong then. You know, it was post Germaine Greer's female eunuch.
The abortion supporters turned up for a...
There was a lot of it on the streets.
But as the banners were unfurled...
The whole atmosphere around the creation of the J's was of a feminist, democratic kind of society in which we all could have a voice and we all should have a voice.
Women broadcasters at that stage were few and far between. The ABC tended to hire women with really nice, deep voices because they were more like men, I suppose. But when we started Double J, we didn't think that was so important.
Gail Austin on Double J, and I've just been given some news.
I was the first woman on air on Double J. Being a woman and being a newbie, I was on Midnight to Dawn. I said, hello, I'm Gail Austin and I've got pink panties on tonight. And I did it as a send-up. I was so sick of all those stereotypical women you see on the TV and everywhere. In those days, women would only be on the TV if they were draped across a nice Porsche that was being sold to a man, or they were in the mum role.
You're at home with ABC.
And I wanted to try and smash that stereotype by sending it up.
Hello, person. I'm a radical feminist. I can do without my bra. I can do without my boyfriend. I can do without my lady sunbeam. I can't do without Double J.
And I had another go at smashing the stereotype. And so I came up with an idea called the Pre-Mid-Dawn Horny Porn Show. For a publicity shot, I had a photo taken with me with no top on, trying to undercut that sexual stereotype. Some of the men on the station were very embarrassed about it. They didn't understand it. Some of the women thought it was the most adventurous thing they'd ever seen and loved it because they knew what I was trying to do.
There was definitely a lack of female voices in the media and the ABC in general. Keri Phillips and Gail Austin were both very prominent broadcasters. And Keri was given a prime shift, and it was just a revelation to be able to listen to a woman who covered issues that were of interest to women for the first time ever.
It's Double J, and this afternoon in the studio we have with us Sherry Height, who, as a doctorate student, was responsible for the Height Report, which explodes a number of long-cherished beliefs about the nature of women's sexuality.
I mean, the ways that women masturbate are so different that you wouldn't believe it.
We've got a few calls on the line, I think. Sherry?
All the sort of personal hang-ups I thought I had about sex, I suddenly found that all these other women had it too.
You stimulate their clitoris to orgasm manually first?
Well, as far as my technique goes, I always start with oral sex.
It was the wildest talkback I think I have ever heard to this day. It was incredibly open and frank. And as a young woman listening to it, I learnt more in that hour or two on Keri's program about my own sexual life than I'd ever learnt reading anything or at school or at university. And it was just mind-blowing, really.
Double J and the ins and outs of love. The threesome.
A lot of guys think it'd be great to go to bed with two birds, but presents certain difficulties to keep the other partner interested, unless, of course, you've got a lesbian relationship with the other partner, which I haven't got with my sister.
The ins and outs of love was broadcast in the first couple of months, and that caused a huge furore.
We believe the ABC is very important because it's symbolical, and I think it's just the whole presentation that glamorising a particular antisocial activity which is taboo.
Chapter 2, the first time.
We came home one night and had our first fumbling furtive screw standing up on the steps, and in the middle of it my father came out and put the dustbins out.
It was extremely controversial. There were MPs complaining about it. There were people saying, look, you know, it's quite wrong that this station should have been set up in the first place.
My first screw was in the back of a Holden, which is pretty typical.
Recognising that the kind of people who listened to the music we were playing thought about things that were going on in the real world that were nothing to do with music, but were interesting, and we reckon, and I think we were right, that they would have different points of view than their parents, and there was nowhere these points of view were being canvassed.
I'm renowned with the Sheilas as the best ferret merchant in the business.
J pioneered free outdoor concerts, and more than 20,000 people packed into Parramatta Park today for the last Double J extravaganza and the end of an era. As of 11 o'clock tomorrow, Double J will be no more, and Triple J will be tuning in now on the FM band.
By 1981, the Maverick radio station had survived numerous attempts to close it down. Broadcasting on the FM band brought not only a new name, but a new sound in crystal clear stereo.
The first person to talk on Triple J was Sammy Collins, and she was a programmer.
Some dum-de-doo-da-day, I stroll in as ever, late in the morning. Have you looked at any pigeonhole? No. Why? There is a memo in there. And it says you are going to be the one to launch us into FM. You're joking. Really? In you go, Sammy. Go and sit down there, and you get to say five words. And I say, good. What are they? And they are,
hello, and welcome to 2 Triple J FM.
Got a song? No? Oh, what are we going to start with? Oh, I don't know. Come on. I don't know. Oh, I know. I've got a great idea. Why don't we play Gay Guys from... Do Guys.
Gay Guys.
was a time of big hair, gauche fashions and flashy lifestyles, and Triple J rolled with it, beginning to recruit celebrities to its on-air lineup.
Jonathan Coleman was a well-known character and performer and was funny, and we thought he'd be, you know, great addition to the station. As it turned out, he was technically completely hopeless, a real bumblefoot.
I'm Jonathan Coleman, by the way. I'm the Jono part of Jono and Dano, and that's where I met Mr. Ian Dano Rogerson.
Who's me?
Ian Rogerson started off as Marius Webb's backup plan to help the station's new star.
Marius grabbed this raw recruit who'd barely spoken into a microphone in his life, and he said to Ian Rogerson, "It's not very good technically. We want Jonathan to focus on his humour, and he's going to sit on the guest side of the desk and you're going to operate and play whatever records need to be played. And by the way, you don't speak. You don't open your mouth."
But I couldn't, you know, seriously, can you? You know, you can't not say anything.
Once they started crying.
After about 10 minutes.
And so Ian Rogerson became this character completely unexpectedly, and suddenly there was this team, Jono and Dano. And together they were fabulous.
16 minutes past two, JJJ, off the record on a Sunday. Hi, I'm a very sporty Dano Mobutu.
And this is Biff Coleman, trackside with
Beautiful
Danny.
Beautiful day.
Well, if you're living in Parramatta or...
We used to love doing OBs as well, because there was very few shows on Triple J that you could do as an outside broadcast. So we did one at the Rocks, we did them at the Easter show every year.
Sunday afternoon, beautiful day outside. Okay.
Listeners around Sydney, Newcastle, Wollongong, wherever you're taking it easy today,
it's 25 minutes to 4 o'clock, JJJ.
We had a PA system and we turned it on. It was sort of not too far from where the chalk display was. The only problem is we played the first record that came out of the PA system, and about half the chooks dropped dead.
That's right, and the rest stopped playing.
It was like a life support system. The Royal Agricultural Society policeman came over and said, "You three J people,
yeah, that's right.
The
that's
three J people."
Shut us down for having a dance party at the Royal Easter Show.
Triple J's pioneering double act became a formula followed by commercial radio to this day.
I'll ruck off.
We were doing ostensibly, a comedy show, but I we were talking about issues, and really a lot of the issues that were around at that time were, you know, what was happening at university and schools.
Indigenous issues and fees. I mean, we would take the piss out of the whatever government was in power at the time.
The size of the Sydney protest surprised even the organisers. They were protesting against the federal budget decision to make students pay an annual administration charge.
During that period of the Hawke era, there was a concentration on skills development and getting qualifications to enter the workforce for young people. And better access to that free university education, I think, was a really important issue. And this is where news and current affairs coverage on Triple J was always very much a priority.
One more call about the student demonstration that happened last night.
It's just really upsetting to look in the paper and see how it's been portrayed as a bunch of students getting, hassling police.
We didn't think of ourselves as doing youth current affairs on youth issues. We were doing the best current affairs and the best coverage of the issues that were important to people in Australia. But we did it from a young person's perspective. One of the highlights of Triple J Current Affairs was the stolen HSC papers scandal back in the mid-80s.
The higher school certificate exams in New South Wales are to go ahead despite the theft of several papers.
A whole lot of HSC papers had been stolen. The education minister at the time said they'd been reset, but it turned out they hadn't, and we got hold of all of the stolen HSC papers and we broadcast one of them, the ancient history exam, which proved that the minister was being untruthful.
Of course, the next day, all hell broke loose and the front page of the tabloid newspaper, the Daily Telegraph, was calling for scalps We were then, of course, interrogated by ABC management, quite rightfully so.
Today, the manager of ABC Radio, Michael Cosby, defended the action of Radio 2 Triple J over its higher school certificate broadcasts.
It became clear that it was a good piece of investigative work. We certainly kept our jobs, so it must have been pretty clear, and the government reset the paper.
JJJ. Tonight's a very special occasion to this station.
Yes. JJJ is having a birthday, and I think it's a wonderful thing.
To celebrate a decade on air, the youth station held a huge birthday bash on Sydney Harbour's Goat Island. The ambitious concert was simulcast on national radio and television and featured a surprise guest band.
For everybody out there who's listening Saturday night, JJJ are the station that have made it possible for a Sydney and Australian musicians to stay alive.
We didn't need to be asked twice. It was an incredible event, partly because of its location, and it was just one of those magic days where, you know, the stars lined up, the birds sang at the right time, you know, the band was in tune and away you went.
We wanted the fireboat crews to do something special during one of the songs. So you took them down, and of course a crate of beer, and got them a bit pissed. In the middle of one of the songs, this fantastic thing, the fireboats all start letting off their hoses. Peter Garrett just couldn't believe it, because one of the things that made them a bit nervous was the first time they'd ever performed on a stage without a back.
Bye, City of Sydney! This is pretty sensational up here, actually, out the back, and I know it's not swimmable in. Oh, hello, a few yachts.
I hear stories now from people who swam with a friend, you know. We thought we were going to get taken by a shark in Sydney Harbour. We swam across to Goat Island and just, you know, sort of crawled out of the water and just listened to you guys playing. Every aspect of it showed the maturation of the Enfant Terrible, you know, the Enfant Terrible, you know, sort of actually delivered something like this in this way. And I still get people coming up to me in the street and saying, oh, yeah, I was just looking at, you know, the Goat Island stuff sort of last week, and so it, there's no question that it did endure.
There was an incredible irreverence and anarchic kind of spirit both around the Oils and that early sense of what Double J and Triple J was about. It was all about being anti-establishment. That was certainly a huge motivation for me when I finally got a gig at Triple J and thought the power of music, you know, it can change the world. Oh, the
power. We were writing about things that were connecting with Triple J's audience. It was about environment, it was about rights for Aboriginal people, it was about nuclear disarmament. These were the issues of the time that we were ringing a bell, and it was ringing in the corridors of the radio station as well.
Midnight Oil was certainly singing about Indigenous issues, but so were Aboriginal bands, and Triple J also played Aboriginal music at the time. Black fella,
white fella, it doesn't matter. The Wurrumpees were a hugely powerful force for us. You know, there was a real changing of attitudes around that time and a real awareness of some of the wrongs. And the music was a really powerful way to tell that story. Are you the one who's gonna stand up and be
counted? J. Between 6 and 10, Monday to Friday, turn it up really loud.
It was dance music and hip-hop were the things that I bought to Triple J. There was a program called the 12-inch single show. There was only talking at the beginning, and the middle and the end, and the rest of the time was beat mixing. The turntables didn't have vary speed, so it was slowing the platter down with your thumb and winding the label really fast, and then wear my thumbs out, keeping up with it. I managed to be the New York correspondent for Triple J for a few months. 1986 in New York was fantastic. Hip-hop had just started to hit its straps. So I came home full of excitement and beans about black music.
Triple J just jumped on rap, you know, and I was trying to stop people just playing lots of rap, you know, because it's a, you know, it's from another culture. It's not 24/7 necessarily Australian, you know, music.
One of the things that was happening in Sydney at the time was a nightclub scene, and the rap parties were really, you know, a part of Sydney's kind of cultural identity at the time. And Triple J certainly were, you know, front and centre of that. Pretty much those dance parties went hand in hand with the early days of ecstasy, and that ecstasy scene did become a part of what we talked about on the station. And no doubt, you know, people were, I'm not saying that they were taking loads of ecstasy at work or anything like that, but people were, you know, were a part of that scene, I suppose.
Hello world, pants off Australia. It's the team of H.G. Nelson and Rampaging Roy Slaven.
In 1986, in the proud tradition of the Triple J double act, another enduring partnership was born.
Hi there, form followers. This is H.G. Nelson getting out of the back of the horse float with a shovel and bucket full of steaming hot doings for the garden on this Sporting Life. Joan got them away.
Triple J appeared to have no interest in sport as program in those days. And I thought that this was a glaring omission, given that so much popular culture revolves around sport. The ambition was to create a parody of a sporting program that might appear on a commercial radio station. Yes. And we model it on the idea, the commercial idea, that there was a person who introduced the topics, acted as the MC, and an older, jaded, experienced personality who could comment on that event or comment on that moment of sporting history, in inverted commas.
It seems to me to be glaringly obvious.
Under the veil of radio, Roy and HG kept their real identities secret.
I think we're a bit concerned that it may not be possible to get any other work anywhere else if we're identified as these particular characters. So we tended to
hide. Somehow the idea of radio is to imagine what these characters are like. If you make it obvious, you think, oh, well, they're nothing like how I thought them to be.
That's right.
Sheep's hearts dipped in jellied squid with onions on the side and the all-new dessert trout with lard and carrot sorbet.
Not forgetting the old standbys of beef bottoms and bullock oysters with devil dog and all meats chock-a-block full of grunt, poke and bounce.
Who's that?
There was something peculiar about our language. If someone was a boofhead, we called them a boofhead. If someone was a dick, we called them a dick. So we weren't backwards in coming forwards in our criticism. But we always wrapped it up by saying it didn't matter what a clown, goose, joke or idiot or boof that someone was. Inevitably, we'd conclude
tremendous.
By saying, but you couldn't meet a nicer bloke.
No, it's a tremendous person. That
couldn't meet a nicer fella. I mean, it's just an error of judgment, a lapse of judgment.
Yeah. And now on this sporting...
I always felt, too, that it was the sort of show where parents and children could listen together and maybe have something to talk about at the end of the show.
Yep, indeed, fine.
A big day in radio right across Australia. The day that Triple J links up with Melbourne from Sydney and soon right around Australia. Has it been like the second coming for you?
It's been like the first.
Oh, sound the trumpet, whatever you got around the house.
Just... We were just like this maverick little radio station, just the Brat Pack Triple J people. But it could never have survived as a Sydney-only radio station.
Has been warned. Now it's here.
Triple J's extension to Adelaide is the ABC's latest step in its plan to have the station broadcasting in all capital cities by the end of the year.
Well, you can look forward to sounds that are always new and a bit challenging. I mean, we're certainly not into classic hits.
Fuck the police coming straight from the underground. A young nigga got it bad because I'm brown. And not the other colour, so police think
Fuck the Police was a single by a band called Niggas With Attitude, NWA, which was all about racial tension and racial inequity and African Americans being on the receiving end of some pretty shabby treatment by the Los Angeles Police Department. We at Triple J at the time very clearly identified the universal message of that song that mirrored the treatment in lots of ways of Aboriginal people in Australia.
You are fucking blood!
Fuck the police!
The ABC said, you can't play Fuck the Police because it's a bad song. It's not just about language, it's about undermining the authority of the police and creating a sense of disrespect and therefore lack of value in what the police are trying to do. And so we, the ABC management, say, don't play that song.
You know, we thought it was outrageous that the ABC should intervene in our editorial decisions.
The Triple J newsroom decided to, you know, do a story on that. We're going to play a little bit of Fuck the Police in that story to highlight what it is that's being banned.
The ABC said the song shouldn't be in the story, but the station's head of news and current affairs went ahead and played it. He was suspended, and Triple J's staff went on strike in support of him. It's gonna be a
bloodbath. And so we'd made a collective decision to go on strike and play the B-side of NWA's Nick of Attitude song of Fuck the Police, which was Express Yourself.
So what you want me to do?
I'm expressing with my full capabilities. And now
we would just pretty much play that day in, day out until people understood that this was an argument about censorship.
I think the Fuck the Police episode was absolutely central to an entire lineup of fantastic broadcasters at Triple J losing their jobs.
That's ridiculous. No one lost a job over Niggas With Attitude. The ABC had decided to totally restructure Triple J, spill all the jobs there to get new blood into the place.
Five primetime presenters were sacked to make way for the new blood, and the station's listeners were furious.
Why I'm here tonight is because I love Gail Austin and I want to see her back on the radio.
Triple J, as I used to know and love it, has become just a piece of crap.
This is only the tip of the iceberg as far as the Free the J's campaign goes.
Triple J's loyal audience came out in droves in support of the sacked presenters and to protest against the changes to their beloved station. Things turned ugly when Andy Neil faced the hostile crowd on behalf of ABC management.
You've come here tonight because you're concerned about Triple J. And you're angry, you're concerned, you're pissed off, for sure, right?
People didn't want to listen to me and people just shouted out bullshit, bullshit, bullshit and had been misinformed that the station was going commercial, so of course they were going to be upset.
So far, 21 people have joined the Triple J Disappeared Club.
My impressions of it was that Triple J was on a mission of growth and that brand Triple J was what they were more interested in than the music.
I think the crucial thing for Triple J is freshness. Fresh ideas, fresh music, fresh voices, fresh approaches to the way radio gets into people's houses and gets into people's heads.
I think the station, even though it changed, I don't necessarily think it changed for the worse.
In the early 90s, as brand Triple J became entrenched in all the capital cities, the new lineup still followed the old mission to reflect trends in youth culture and new music.
There was amazing music scenes happening in the 90s. There were the rap parties and the dance parties. That was a big part of it. Not too long after that, you know, Seattle rock just exploded. All of a sudden, this band Nirvana come along and they released this record. Come as you are. I took it to work that day, played Teen Spirit on my show that afternoon. Everyone loves it. Triple M fans love it. 2 Day FM fans love it. My brother loves it. He loves Midnight Oil.
Nirvana was on its first and only Australian tour when it played at the inaugural Big Day Out Festival in Sydney. Triple J was the host broadcaster.
We presented the tour, and the tour, as everyone now knows, you know, coincided with the album going number one in America.
What history had shown is that they weren't particularly excited about the media at all doing interviews. And so every time they were wheeled into a station, it was really reluctantly.
In the studio is Nirvana, and welcome, guys. Thank you for coming in.
Yes, yeah.
It was a live interview because Triple J liked to do things live, I think because of the energy of live.
You toured pretty extensively over the end of last year. How did they get to you? Did you get
really
tired?
People were saying that we were getting uptight and pissed off and cranky, but they
to heck with them!
To heck with them, for fooey.
All three of them came in. They didn't want to be there. I was green and I was nervous and a fan, and it was just a perfect storm. It was a disaster.
And was there much pressure on you to stay back home?
Dave was using scissors to cut our new mic socks. I think Chris was looking out the window at one point. Kurt had his head on the desk, clearly very ill.
Okay. We might go to another track. We seem to be having some technical problems.
I think I realised it was a car crash. I cut it as short as I could. And then played a track and turned speakers up and looked away and just wanted them to leave.
I don't even remember listening to the radio until I knew of Triple J. That's how we heard. Bands like Nirvana and stuff. Triple J, the first people to ever play Silverchair as well.
I was working at ABC Local Radio at the time that Silverchair were uncovered, and that was a joint thing between, you know, SBS and Triple J. And in fact, this very studio where we're sitting now, Studio 227, was where they recorded their first music for Triple J, where Tomorrow was recorded.
We were already thinking we're going to be at the top. It's going to be a big deal. And we came in here and we were just blown away. Because we were used to recording in, like, little Newcastle garages and tiny little studios in Newcastle, like, this big. And we walked in here, it was like, we walked into, like, a cathedral or something. Triple J was vital for us. Without them, we'd probably still be in a garage jamming.
Australian music has had a lot of great successes over the last 40 years. And without Triple J, probably two-thirds of them would never have reached critical mass.
The arrival of the Big Day Out, for the first time, it was really starting an urban-based festival. And the fact that Triple J existed and was broadcasting in those cities and allowed the audience to hear those kind of bands enabled that kind of festival culture to grow.
Australia has become one of the music capitals of the world in popular music, and Triple J is, of course, playing a tremendous role in all that.
In 1994, the ever-expanding Triple J began its reach into regional Australia. Suddenly, a whole new world of music and ideas opened up for young people in country areas.
Having grown up in a regional town and seeing the difference that having Triple J go into those communities had made, it was profound.
Take it away, Roy.
Yes, thank you very, very much, H.G. Nelson. Tremendous to be here.
What it means to us is a chance to talk to a whole new bunch of people, which is fun.
Now that's Tom Jones on Hard Coffee.
Where were you that day?
For some reason, they didn't let me go to the Parliament House. I don't know why. I just realised. But I was not invited. I was like, I want to meet PJ Carley. They're like, no, Helen, you have to stay here and do important core stuff. Morning, you're on Triple J.
Oh, we all knew that raise at 6:04 on a Tuesday morning. In fact, the date today is...
Clearly, I'm Helen Razor, and I was and pretty much remain the voice of a generation.
Yeah,
that's by some guy, Mikey.
I'm Mikey Robbins. I was her minder.
we were as we remain, which is very ill-formed adults. Well, genuinely appalling people.
I used to describe the show as a pair of 12-year-olds with credit cards.
The big thing about me is that I masturbate a fuck of a lot.
I'm possessed by Satan.
It's 9 past 7, new Australian music here.
That's right, Mikey.
Yes.
The music was, of course, important, central, the most important
thing. It was the most important thing.
Still is the most important thing about Triple J. I mean, we're really just a sort of a...
accessory.
Know, we're an amuse-bouche, to the main dish of the music.
The main thrust of the show was never actually to go for a gag. It was actually to have a conversation. We used to do one. Valentine's Day. It used to be gay and lesbian only Valentine's Day. And you get this lovely fact.
Gay, lesbian, bisexual, trans, gender, intersex, queer.
Gay. Pissed off a lot of the stuff. Pissed off a lot of people.
I know. But, and it's angry straight people ringing you and say, why do you hate straight people, you queers? Because they're dull.
Yeah, you get these nice letters from a 15, 16-year-old kid in a country town just saying, look, thanks for doing that.
Triple J's reach into regional Australia saw the station launch its unearthed talent spotting competition in 1995. For the first time, country kids had the chance to expose their music on national radio and possibly get their big break.
The first one that we did was in Lismore. You would be surprised by how many bands or people that thought they could play music lived around the Lismore sort of region. And so we waded through all of that. But in the end, Grinspoon were the winners. Woo!
After winning the inaugural Unearthed, Grinspoon went on to record 7 albums and sell more than 500,000 records.
I heard the other day that Unearthed is in Dubbo now. I didn't believe him at first, and then I heard it on the radio, so we express posted a tape down to Sydney.
While Triple J went on to unearth scores of bands since Grinspoon, with varying degrees of success, the station continued to scour the country for new on-air talent.
We're originally based in Melbourne and we used to do stuff once a week for the princely sum of $50. Yes.
That's we would have done it for nothing, but don't tell them.
I know, we would have too, actually. We were desperate for the attention.
I was Merrick and Rosso's producer when they moved to the Drive program. They were pretty green, but they were pretty funny, and they knew each other really well, so they had that real quality of announcers and of mates. They just found each other hilarious, and so it's really infectious when you do that.
You know, we were fortunate because largely, you know, more people listening to Triple J probably liked us than hated us, but...
Oh, they warmed to you, you know, and we were warned about that. You know, so they'll hate you first and then they'll love you.
Yeah. Mm. And then you'll leave them and they'll hate you again.
They hate you again. Why don't you leave?
According to some experts, the millennium bug could cost the world economy $1 trillion.
We were all bracing ourselves in 1999 for the bug, weren't we? Mm. And we were all frightened here because we didn't know whether the CD machines would work.
Triple J, along with the rest of the world, did survive Y2K, but the self-confessed bogans from Melbourne did their best to interrupt transmission anyway.
I did shut down the radio network. In the studios, when you go in, on the left-hand side, there's a... It's not a button, it's a dial. And there was a sign that says very clearly, do not, under any circumstances, flick this switch. And Rosso said on air, Mez, why don't you go and flick the switch? And I said, okay, but he was joking. Mm. But I thought he was joking, like joking, but do it joking. And it was joking, don't do it joking.
See if you can go over there and turn it off. See whether you can turn it off.
I'll shut it off.
One, two, three.
And we're live on air, and every single screen, every single button on the desk, everything just went black and just went booted down.
Did I shut down the radio station?
We
had to shut it off.
I was joking.
What the hell did you just do?
They just told me to shut it off.
Fucking idiot.
We'd been talking, and I noticed that there was one level bouncing on the screen. So the quirk of the studio was that if it was a power cut, the last thing that was playing would stay up. And, of course, the last thing that was on was the microphones. And so it heard the whole conversation.
And, of course, no one noticed. Like, everyone listened, but there was, like, no one walked in and went, hey, guys. It's like, because it would have been after 4:15, so there was no one left in the building.
No, everyone was off to drinks.
Yeah.
Launching the first new FM radio station in Sydney in 20 years.
Ladies and gentlemen of the media, I give you Nova 96.9.
When Merrick and Rosso defected to a new commercial rival in early 2001, their departure was a sign of the times. Triple J was struggling to compete with commercial radio's marketing budgets. Listeners were switching over and the station was reeling.
Triple J, in a way, wasn't cool anymore. You know, the shine had gone off the brand, the morale for many of the staff was low, and the place really felt, in many ways, on its knees. The first thing that became really clear to me was that if Triple J stayed just as a radio station, that we were ensuring our own irrelevance. And so I guess very early on I decided that kind of our internal mantra had to be really that we had to be more than a radio station. So that's really building our web presence. It was starting to get into social media. It was thinking about television, so we started JTV.
I would like everyone here to make very welcome your friend and ours, Missy Higgins.
Just a few years before Missy Higgins became a huge draw card at Triple J concerts like this one, she was an undiscovered 17-year-old songwriter in Geelong.
I used to actually listen to Triple J in the mornings when I was kind of getting ready for school, but I'd missed the Unearthed thing for some reason. So when my sister and her boyfriend sent in a tape recording of my song All For Believing to Unearthed, I didn't really think much of it. I just kind of forgot about it. And then a couple of months later, I got a phone call from someone at the station and she was like, hi, is that Missy? Now, are you sitting down? I think you should take a seat. I've got some very big news for you. And then she said, you've won Triple J Unearthed. And I had no idea what she was talking about because I'd totally forgotten.
Pull back the shield between us and I'll kiss you. Drop your...
I was at that very first gig and she was wonderful.
I'm all for believing, I'm all for believing.
She downplayed a lot of things. She's a very quiet, gentle person. And it was just really lovely to see someone like that come to the fore.
I've tried coming.
It can be really hard for a band that doesn't get played on Triple J because they are such an outlet for Aussie indie musicians that's not available anywhere else.
We are hearts coming to.
If you made a list of the Australian artists who've gone on to make what you would consider the most important albums of their eras and to make waves around the world, almost without exception, they were championed by Triple J first.
I guess I was sending demos to Triple J when I was making tracks in my bedroom. That was 14 years ago when I started making sort of sample-based tracks that eventually I put together under the Gautier project name.
We supported Gautier from the very beginning. He sent in to me when I was doing the Australian Music Show his hand-printed demo tape on CD. I remember I rang him or emailed him and I said, I want to play you on the radio, but I have absolutely no idea how to pronounce your name. What the hell is Gotcha or Gautier or whatever it is?
Richard's show, I guess, early on, was maybe the first time I was played on Triple J, and it was incredibly exciting.